you're alive. You roll, you rain, you say you're coming back again. I know you will, all the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. You take our sins away, oh God. You give your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of your great love. You live, you die, you said in 3 days you would rise, you did. You're alive. You rule, you reign. You say you're coming back again. I know all the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. Sing your praises. You take our sins away, oh God. You gave your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of your great love. Said in 3 days you would rise, you did. You're alive. You rule, you reign. You say you're coming back again. I know you will. All the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. Will sing your praises. You live, you die. You said in 3 days you would rise. You did. You're alive. You rule, you reign. You say you're coming back again. I know you will. All the earth will sing your praises. You live. Said in 3 days you would rise, you did. You're alive. You rule, you reign. You say you're coming back again. I know that you will. All the earth will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your praises. Will sing your praises. All the earth will sing your
dead will rise. Through you our hearts will praise. Through you the darkness flees. Through you my heart screams, I am free. the blind will see. Through you, the mute will sing. Through you, the dead will rise. Through you, our hearts will praise. Through you, the darkness flees. Through you, my heart screams, I am free. Blind will see, through you the mute will sing, through you the dead will rise, through you our hearts will praise, through you the darkness flees, through you my heart screams, I am
believe that? Amen. A little distortion roll through there. It's good for the soul. Tonight our look in John 16 is in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No other name that every knee shall bow and tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord.
Jesus.
your name. Jesus, I love you. For when I was blind and lost, you shed for all your enemies your blood upon the cross. Because you have loved me, now I can love you too. Love flows deep into my heart, and I send it back to you. Jesus, our love will only grow much deeper, sustained from above by your overflowing grace. Jesus, our love will only grow much sweeter, and someday we shall be together face to face. Jesus, I love you. For when I was blind and lost, you shed for all your enemies your blood upon the cross. Because you have loved me, now I can love. Love flows deep into my heart, and I send it back to you. Jesus, our love will only grow much deeper, sustained from above by your overflowing grace. sustained from above by your overflowing grace. Jesus, our love will only grow much sweeter, and someday we shall be together face to face. Oh, and someday we shall. We praise you, King of glory. We praise you, Prince of peace. We lift our voice to heaven and we praise your name. We praise you, King of heaven. We praise you, Lord of earth. We lift our hands to heaven and we praise your name. And you reign in glory, reign in majesty. We praise you, King of glory. We praise you, Prince of peace. We lift our voice to heaven and we praise your name. We praise you, King of heaven. We praise you, Lord of earth. We lift our hands to heaven and we praise your name. You reign in glory. eternally.
Sing it again.
You reign in glory, reign in majesty.
Thank you for our evening together, Lord. Everyone that's here, as we've gathered together, you say you inhabit the praises of your people. I love that, Father. And thank you that you do, Father. We need to be in your presence tonight. And we need your touch, and we need resources from heaven. We need your divine power, be connected to your divine nature, everything about you, Father. We need you. And we're all in, Father, tonight. We cry out to you that we're nothing without you, and how we desperately need you. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to fill this place, and Lord, with everything that's going on this campus, with each class that's going on, and with our children and Juana's, and as they're hiding your word in their heart, that, Lord God, that you would just use your word tonight and open our ears, Holy Spirit, open our heart and prepare us, and Lord, that we understand this incredible institution of prayer that you gave us, that we can come to the Father and ask anything in your name, and you say you'll do it. We thank you for that. And so, Father, we come to you tonight just asking you to open us up, open our hearts, open our minds, open our ears, and speak into us, change us, conform us, transform us, make us more like you. We need you in every way. In Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Why don't you be seated?
little slow getting hooked up here, sorry. I got it finally. There you go. Yeah. I just need you to stand up. That's all. Okay. I have a video I'm going to let you see, and just forewarning you that it might make you angry, and I hope it does. Just hope it doesn't make you angry at me. And it shouldn't. If you get angry and you're angry at me, you're angry at the wrong person. But I've been talking a lot about this SB6 bill, and there's a lot of action going on, and a lot of reaction going on. I just wanted you to see a video, a commercial that's already been put out there against the state of Texas. And go ahead and roll it, Tom.
Texas lawmakers want to pass SB6, the bathroom bill, keeping transgender people from using the bathrooms that they identify with.
Now we can stop the bill, but there's only one way.
You've got to roll up your sleeves, pull down your pants, and pee with LGBT.
You got to take a seat to make a stand.
You got to spray it to say it.
Because this isn't a privacy issue.
And we can take care of ourselves.
Because money should be spent keeping kids in school, not out of bathrooms. Don't run in my hallway.
Because passing that bill discriminates against family and friends.
And me.
And that guy.
Because SB6 threatens Texas businesses.
And because we damn sure ain't gonna end up like North Carolina.
IP.
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 IP with LGBT.
Because everybody pees, and everybody deserves a safe place too.
IP with LGBT.
Well, there you go. Just thought I'd share that with you. It'll make you hopefully mad. That's what I hope it does. I'm going to show it Sunday to make people mad. Yeah, and I'm scanning everything that I've gotten from that meeting, particularly phone numbers, and Sunday I'm going to be handing that out. You need to start making phone calls. You need to start writing emails. If the church puts its head in the sand, then we deserve everything that we get. And actually, the percentage behind that is so small. And it's like the pastor, there was one of the pastors, I can't remember his name. I need to try to find that clip of him sharing this, because he shared it with the simulcast that we did with Grace Community Church back when the Houston mayor was after those pastors. And he, that same pastor, was at this meeting we went to in Austin. And he said, you know, I was involved in the civil rights movement. He said, but this ain't about civil rights. This is about special rights. Because, you know, nobody else's rights are being considered in that bathroom except for the gays. That's it. And we got to do something. And I don't intend on being quiet about it. I intend to try to, I'm going to pass it off to you. This is the world you live in, so, and that you're raising your children in, and we need to do something about it. Yeah, they're not reporting on the news some of the things that are happening. So when we were at that meeting, there are already sexual assaults that have occurred in the bathroom with this transgender thing going on in the bathrooms. And the media is not telling you, because big business and the media is behind all of it. You already got the NFL and the NBA reacting against it.
A 8-year-old little girl was assaulted by a man who went in the women's restroom
the week that we were in Austin. Yeah, there was a sexual assault on a 4-year-old. By a man in the wrong bathroom. So, anyhow, there you go. Glad I made you feel good. And sorry, but it's the world we live in. You're the salt and you're light of that world. Amen. And guess what? It's appropriate that we look at in Jesus' name, because that is what it's going to require. And every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And it's just a matter of whether you bow now or you bow later. Thought I'd let that sink in. It's just a matter of whether or not you bow now or you bow later, but every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess. And anyhow, we looked at John 16, 16 through 33. And by the way, I wrote today, emailed Dave Welsh. He's the guy that heads up the Texas Pastors Council, and that's the group of guys that were subpoenaed, that Pastors Five, and just in reaction to that video, and said, dude, send us whatever you got and tell us whatever we need to do, because we're ready. And so curious to see what response I get back on that. John 16, 16 through 33. A little while and you will no longer see me. And again, a little while and you will see me. A little picky boo going on. Some of the disciples then said to one another, what is this thing he's telling us? A little while and you will not see me. And again, a little while and you will see me. And because I go to the Father, so they were saying, what is that he says a little while? We do not know what he's talking about. And Jesus knew that they wished to question him. And he said to them, are you deliberating together about this, that I said a little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me? Truly, truly, I say to you that you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will grieve, but your grief will be turned into joy. Whenever a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when she gives birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy that a child has been born into the world. Therefore, you too have grief now, but I will see you again, and your heart will rejoice, and no one will take your joy away from you. In that day, you will not question me about anything. Truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you've asked for nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, so that your joy may be made full. These things I've spoken to you in figurative language. An hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figurative language, but will tell you plainly of the Father. In that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will request of the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came forth from the Father. I came forth from the Father and have come into the world. I am leaving the world again and going to the Father. His disciples said, lo, now you are speaking plainly and are not using a figure of speech. Now we know that you know all things and have no need for anyone to question you. By this we believe that you came from God. And Jesus answered, do you now believe? Now there was a tone of sarcasm in that question. Behold, an hour is coming, and it has already come, for you to be scattered, each to his own home, and to leave me alone. And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage, I have overcome the world. And there's a ton of things there, and we looked at this, read this whole passage last week, but we spent really most of our time really looking at this idea of our sorrow or our pain being transformed into joy. And he doesn't come in our lives and take all of our sorrow and pain away and replace it with his joy. He actually takes all the sorrow and pain in our life and transforms it into joy. It's that same thing of beauty from ashes, or that what the enemy meant for harm in your life, God works it together for good. Takes all these things that are going on in our life and works it out into a beautiful thing. I think of Grove Norwood. Probably when I think of that verse, I think of him first and foremost. And where Grove lost his 4-year-old child, it was ran over. And when they're trying to investigate to figure out this hit and run, and found out that it's a friend of his, and that friend didn't realize he had hit. It was an elderly gentleman, and he didn't realize. He didn't see her. He thought he hit an animal. And when Grove finds out it's him, he goes out to him and, you know, just extends love to him and forgiveness to him. It shook the community of Fulshire over there. And what is that other little area there? Simonton. Yeah, just shook that community. And partly because of racial lines, you know, that Grove's white and the elderly gentleman was black. But they were friends and had been friends for a long time. And Grove helped him in many ways. And And when this thing happened, the tensions kind of rose about, is there going to be backlash towards this man? And Grove went to his house, extended forgiveness to him, invited them to sit at the front row with him as family, bought his wife a dress, and it just blew the community away. And you know, Grove, though, that night after they buried his child, and he's really kind of sick of hearing everybody's words of encouragement and favorite Bible scriptures. You know, he's just hurting inside. He's numb, and he goes outside and he's just shaking his finger at God, the heavens, and he's like, I get it. I understand. I think Euless was his name, the old elderly gentleman. I understand it. I get it. I have no problem with understanding that it was an accident and forgiving my friend. I have no problem with that. Any of this, you know, I get it. But you're going to have to show me how something good could possibly come out of this, because I don't see it. And yet, you know, when I came into Grove's life sometime later, you know, when I went to Angola with him and he's sharing his story, at that point he was beginning to see it, because here's that story of forgiveness hit Promise Keepers, and then it turned into a full-fledged film. And then it started being used in prisons all over the state, and then used in prisons all over the country, and he didn't even know it. And then when he gets invited to go to Angola, and he sees that seminary in Angola that warden had started, and decides, I'm going to start that in Texas. And now we have a seminary in Texas, and has fixing to have another graduating class, sending pastors out into all these prisons. He sees it now, what the enemy meant for harm to this terrible tragedy. God transformed it into something incredibly beautiful beyond what he could have ever even imagined. You couldn't have told him that he'd be on the ride that he's been on these last years of his life. And it's just a crazy, incredible story. So that's part of what we looked at. And even the cross, I mean, that's exactly what the cross is and what he's talking about here, that I must go away. He's talking about the cross and this terrible thing, but this cross is fixed to be transformed into salvation and redemption for anybody that would call upon the name of the Lord. You know, it's an incredible, beautiful story. And but what we kind of glazed over last week was this part of 23, because intermingled in all this about going and coming and, you know, being buried, and, you know, he's talking about his death, he's talking about his resurrection, and he's talking about the ascension in part of it. And in all of this conversation, in the context of all this, he blurts out this in verse 23, in that day, and he's talking about after his resurrection, in that day, you will not question me about anything. Truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, I'll give it to you. And he begins to talk about prayer. And I've got it highlighted in there three times, in my name, in my name, in my name. And there's something really significant going on here. And I wrote in your notes there, this is a new edict. And that's just, you know, when I was starting to jot thoughts down, I'm really not real good with vocabulary, believe it or not. It may be why God chose me to be a preacher, because he likes to confound the wise with foolish things. So he makes me a pastor. It's just the craziest thing. And how words will pop in my mind that I really don't know what that word means, and I'll have to go look it up, and wow, you know, an edict. That's what I felt the Lord was saying. It was a new edict, and meaning that it was a new official order, a proclamation issued by a person in authority. And here is Jesus, who is about to go to the cross. He's about to be buried. He's about to defeat death and hell. He's about to rise again from the grave. And then at the ascension, what is it he says at the ascension? I know I'm getting ahead of myself, but we'll just look at it again when we get there. All authority has been given to me, right? So he is speaking out of authority about what's going to happen in that day. After this has all transpired, in that day when all authority has been given to me, you're going to ask for anything in my name, and I'm going to give it to you. I wrote several different synonyms there: decree, order, command, commandment, mandate, proclamation, pronouncement. This is really what this is right here. In verse 23 and those following verses, it's on the institution of prayer where Father God is openly accessible. If Jesus was teaching those disciples anything, he was teaching them constantly that Father God is openly accessible. And now he's saying, you're going to have access to the very ears and heart of God, And we do. We have access to kingdom things from heaven. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And so this process, which had not yet been exercised before, this is a new thing. Up until this point, you've got high priests, you've got prophets who certainly experienced, you know, unique dialogue with God. Can you imagine being the high priest for the nation of Israel, and yet they've been a history of being so sinful that they've got a tradition of tying a bell around your waist and a rope on you so in case you go in the Holy of Holies and on the Day of Atonement and you drop dead, they don't hear the bell anymore, they can pull you out of there. There are some people that had unique encounters with the presence of God. You think of the prophets. You think of judges, all the judges, certain people. Think of Moses having, you know, the only man that you see in the Old Testament of having conversation face-to-face with God as a man with another man. Incredible direct dialogue. Abraham, think of Abraham having a conversation with God. But that was a very limited experience for humanity at that time. Everybody wasn't accessing God on that kind of direct dialogue. It was limited with the schemes and the plans of what God was doing in the earth in that epoch of time. But Jesus is decreeing to his disciples that an hour is coming, and it soon will be, you're going to have complete and constant access to the presence of God. Just as a son approaches his father for things that are of need, we have access to Father God. It's a glimpse of the priesthood of the believers. You all have access to the Father. And let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. That's not just for me. That's not just for a few special elite. That's for every believer in Jesus Christ. You have access to the throne of God. It was a decree. It was a command. It was a process of answered prayer that would be brought directly from the presence and throne of Father God, asked in the name of his Son Jesus. It's new. It's new because the reason it's a new season or a new epoch in the institution of prayer, it's new for several reasons. And part of it is that the context of all that Jesus is saying in verse 23 and 24 and 25 as he's talking about prayer, he's now talking about prayer under the resurrection power of Jesus. That's what he's talking about. Nobody yet has prayed with the resurrection power of Jesus. So when he's talking about praying in the name of Jesus, he's talking about praying with the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. It takes a new day to do that. It takes something to happen. The resurrection had to have occurred for this to happen before. The death of Jesus by itself is only a death. All men die. So the death into itself is not what's so special, because all men die. It's the resurrection. Amen? It's the resurrection, because Jesus was the only man on the face of the earth that had the ability to die and return. He's the only one. Acts 2:24 says, but God raised him up, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held in its power. There was no chance, no pun intended, there was no chance in hell that he could be contained by death, because the devil had nothing in him. See, until we have Jesus in us, the devil has something in us. He does, because actually you even hear Jesus as he talks about, you know, your father Satan. But until we had Jesus in us and we were born again, our seed was corrupt. We were not from incorruptible seed. We were from corrupt seed. And the devil certainly had a grip of death upon us. So there's a few things of great impact upon prayer, which prayer had not contained up until this moment before the resurrection. In verse 23, Jesus says, you'll no longer question me concerning things in that day that is coming. Think of all the encounters that these disciples had with Jesus. Think of it. I mean, it's almost in every instance when you read the Gospels and Jesus is teaching them something, or he performs a miracle, or even when they're attempting to perform miracles and fail to perform miracles, and who they go to? Jesus. Start asking him questions. Even Jesus, teach us how to pray, right? All these conversations, all these comments, even in this text that we see here, as Jesus is teaching them, fixing to go to the cross. And even in this, they're having dialogue with him. They even think that they might need to correct Jesus a little bit here. They're trying to figure out, what does he mean by this? What does he mean by that? And that doesn't make sense, Jesus. And, oh, now we hear you're not talking figuratively anymore. Oh, really? You think I'm not talking? You think you understand now? You're fixing to be in just a few hours. You're fixing to abandon me. You know, they've got no clue. All of this questioning, all of this inquiring that they're doing, and questions and comments and reasoning with Jesus. And then Jesus says in verse 23, in that day you will no longer ask of me. In that day there will be a new protocol. A new protocol. You know, that's kind of what I set up with Reuben. Reuben's our new associate pastor, and in some cases I set up a protocol. I don't want everybody coming to my office to ask me about everything. You know, go ask him. You ask my wife. I'll even do that to her. She'll come into my office and ask me about that, and I'll say, go ask that person. You know, that's the protocol, you know, because I don't want to get in the habit of having to answer every stinking little detail. I'm not concerned. This is what I'm trying to spend my time doing, you know. I have a responsibility for that, you know. There's a protocol, and Jesus is saying there is a new protocol. You've been coming to me for information and for revelation and for this and for that, but guess what? In that day, you're not going to come to me anymore. Guess what we're going to have? Holy Spirit. You realize all these chapters, he's been talking about Holy Spirit. I must go. As a matter of fact, it's to your advantage. This is what we looked at a couple of weeks ago. It's to your advantage that I go, because when the Helper comes, he's going to teach you. He's going to illuminate things for you. Even the things I'm speaking to you right now that you don't remember, you won't be able to recall it tomorrow, but a year from now, when you actually need that information, I've already planted it in your spirit, and Holy Spirit's going to illuminate it for you. That's the way it works. And that's what Jesus is trying to tell them. And there's another significant shift. Not only Holy Spirit, not only where we don't need to inquire of Jesus for everything. Jesus is at the command center. He's standing at the right hand of the Father, right? Holy Spirit is in every one of us. And he is the one that is illuminating and speaking and teaching and showing something. But there's also another significant thing here. When he's teaching, look at when Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. In the Lord's Prayer, and we use that all the time. We've got part of it on our wall. And it's a significant teaching of how to pray directly to the Father. And Jesus said in verse 24 of our text that we just read, that until now, you have asked for nothing in my name, right? And when you look at the Lord's Prayer, look at Matthew 6, 7 through 13. And when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition as the Gentiles do, for they suppose that they'll be heard for their many words. So do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask. Pray then in this way: Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so through all this prayer, he's trying to teach them. He's trying to make them aware. There's an open heaven. You have access to God, directly to God. And even letting us know that things that are going on in heaven, we want to see that going on in the earth. And even Jesus teaching us in John 16, 23, I think it's the same kind of heart that he's teaching in prayer. Ask anything in my name, I'll do it, because nothing's impossible to God. And so if nothing's impossible for God, then all things actually are accessible to his kids. Amen? And so just as the Lord's Prayer begins with an open, exclusive invitation, personalizes our relationship with Father God through two simple words, our Father. It's really beautiful. I mean, just think about those two words. How you could have tossed to pray a jillion different ways, and he begins praying this way, our Father. It's exclusive here. And then the next point of the prayer, it acknowledges the position and the authority. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And the expository's Bible commentary states that God's name is a reflection of who he is. Therefore, to pray that God's name be hallowed is not to pray that God may become holy, but that he may be treated as holy. And this, and that his name should not be despised by the thoughts and conduct of those who've been created in his name. So we notice in that instruction of the Lord's Prayer, which, and by the way, when Jesus was teaching the Lord's Prayer, just to make a note, it wasn't trying to teach them what to pray. It was trying to teach them how to pray. And Jesus never asked, and Jesus never said, ask for things in my name, did he, in the Lord's Prayer? Didn't say it. You don't see anywhere prior to this point of Jesus hanging out with the disciples, ask things in my name. Not yet. But in John 16:23, Jesus instructed them that in the hour of his return, in his departure, meaning his resurrection and his ascension, you'll thus forth, I don't know why I did it a couple times, I just kind of was in a King James verbiage for some reason. It's just coming out me that way. Sorry. Ask for things in my name. There are two reasons for this process. Here's the first one. Prayer stated in the name of Jesus reveals faith. Simply coming to pray in the name of Jesus to the Father, asking for things to the Father in the name of Jesus, is a demonstration of faith. Because the Father loves those who loves Jesus. That's what he says in that passage. Jesus said that to him. Father loves you. Why does he love you? He loves you because you love me. And because you believe that he sent me. And see, when you start praying in the name of Jesus, that's the first thing you're doing. You're affirming the will of the Father in the earth that, yes, I sent my son. He's my son and I sent him. The King of the universe. And because you're acknowledging that and you love him, you bring pleasure to the Father when you pray in the name of Jesus. It's really an affectionate phrase to say in the name of Jesus. And what I'm trying to kind of disrupt here a little bit is too much in religion and church. We turn it into voodoo. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. And we have probably based that off of, you know, that in the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. That's a reality. Every knee is going to bow and every tongue shall confess. But that doesn't mean that you turn that into some kind of that because I said it like it's a spell. And sometimes people treat it that way. But it's not. It's affectionate to say that in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I'm acknowledging, Father, he is your son. I am full-heartedly believe that he's your son. And you sent him into the earth. And I'm in agreement with that. It's a beautiful thing. In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will request to the Father on your behalf. Look, he said, I'm not going to say I'm going to request to the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you. He loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came forth from the Father. See, if I send to you to Aztec Otto and... I was trying to think, what Acme is what I was trying to think of, and it didn't come to my brain. You know, all the cartoons, it was always, the business was always Acme something, you know. So if I sent you to Acme Auto, and my friend Juan works there, and I'm only using the name Juan because I actually have a friend named Juan who works at an auto place, right? And matter of fact, when I first met him and he fixed something in our car just unbelievably cheap and did an incredible job, I turned to him and said, you're a new member of our family. I'm putting you in my phone right now. Did I not? And so if you had a car problem and I said, hey, go over there to Acme Auto and tell Juan that Greg sent you. Now, when you go over there and you say that Greg sent you, he's going to light up. Is he not? Oh, yeah. You're a friend of Greg's, and it actually might get you a better deal, and it's going to get me a better deal when I show up there again because I brought him more business, right? Favor. There's favor within that. Favor for you, favor for me, and that's partly, I think, what we're saying here, that there is a tremendous favor that's involved in this because when you start praying in the name of Jesus, I believe God smiles. I believe he smiles. Yes! That's my son. He gets it. He gets it. Because there's a lot of people on the earth don't get it. You have full access to the Father, and he loves us, and the use of the name of Jesus simply broadcasts your love for the Father and for his son, and it resounds faith before him that you believe Jesus is exactly who he declares that he is. Now, on one hand, praying in Jesus' name is a declaration of faith and love that we just talked about, but it's also a reverence. It's a reverence to the position and the authority of who Jesus really is. That's the second part of this. to expound on that second point, Jesus was without sin, and death could not contain him. And therefore, you know, had the devil known what he was doing when he crucified Jesus, Scripture said he would have never done it. It turned into his worst nightmare when he crucified Jesus. He had no idea. You see, the devil had stolen, or actually, you know, you have to really put it in terms of rights. He kind of rightfully took it from Adam and Eve, because Adam and Eve kind of rightfully gave it away because they disobeyed God. So they forfeited that dominion of which they had. And so now Satan's got it. And we know Adam sinned, and because he sinned, guess what? All of us did. So we're all in the same boat. We've got this sin grip of death upon our life. We've got this incorruptible seed in here. But now here's Jesus, born of a virgin, right? Not of that incorruptible seed, or a corruptible seed, but of incorruptible seed, coming to the earth. Death does not have a grip on his life because he's never sinned. That is not in him. That's why when we read John at one point where he says that he's coming and the devil's got nothing in me. That's what he meant. The devil has no grip of sin. There's no sin to entice. You know, that movie of the last temptation of Christ is just a bunch of bull, because there was no tempt. We're drawn away and enticed by our own lust. He had no lust to be enticed with. He had no sin in him, no corruption in him. And because he had no sin and corruption in him, he had no death penalty upon him. And so here's the devil in his own deception and delusions, not thinking about due process of law. Because, you know, we think we're so brilliant as human beings with all of our courts and all of our systems and all of our arguing over law. And somehow man thinks he came up with all this stuff. Due process of law is something that was within the kingdom of God. All of these things that we've built, it's just systems that are dimly representative of the purity and the righteousness and the justice of God's law. And there's a due process of law in God's kingdom. And Jesus was not treated correctly. He was not under a penalty of death. And the devil came against him and crucified him, caused him to be killed. He murdered him. He committed a crime against him. And therefore, because of that crime, he forfeited. He lost what hold he had. He lost it. That's where we believe, I do believe, during that 3 days that Jesus is in the grave. I believe that he went to hell. I believe, and I don't believe it was a struggle. Sometimes we see little skits where it shows Jesus and the devil going back and forth. I think he thumped him in the head. I'm sorry. I think he just slapped him down and took those keys away from him and went and opened up those who were unjustly there and led the captives free. It wasn't a struggle whatsoever, because he rightfully had taken it. Give it to me, it's mine. That's what he did. There was a lot of activity, I believe, going on in those 3 days. So you have now Jesus with all authority. He's got it now. Rightfully took it back. Had to be a man. A man lost it, and a man had to get it back. And that's why God came to the earth in the form of man. We have Jesus. So, where am I at? I don't know. I quit looking at my notes. So, let me figure it out here. To expand on the second point, I think I talked through that pretty good. All authority has been given to me. That's where it brings us to this place of Jesus being able to proclaim at his ascension. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So, just as in the Lord's Prayer, where we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, acknowledging, Jesus was teaching them, acknowledge the position of God, acknowledge his worthiness, acknowledge his holiness, acknowledge who he is. And in the same way, Jesus is teaching them this portion of prayer, that when you pray in the name of Jesus. And what you do also when you pray in the name of Jesus, besides being a statement of faith and of affection, it's also a declaration of his authority and who he is. So the Father's name is holy. He's to be treated holy, and we're declaring that in the heavens when we pray the Lord's Prayer before the throne of that Jesus. And when we pray in Jesus' name, we're also declaring that Jesus is Lord of all. That's what we're declaring. And that he has all authority and all power of heaven and earth and should be treated, what?
Thus.
You see what I wrote there? Not sure what's up with the King James lingo. Just been coming out of me that way lately. It came out of me Sunday once. Thus. Thus. Where'd that come from? So, going back to verse 23, which is really our key verse of the evening. In that day, you will not question me about anything. Truly, truly, I say to you, if you ask the Father for anything in my name, he'll give it to you. So sharing, Jesus is sharing with his disciples the power of the resurrection that has now made praying in the name of Jesus possible. So the next time you rattle off your prayers in the name of Jesus, don't be flippant. Don't use it just as a spiritual phrase, because it was made possible through a death and a resurrection. When you stand before men and you pray, so I have to do this every year. I'll be doing it again. I think it's in May. Since I've been pastoring, I get invited every time to go downtown Houston and sing the Star Spangled Banner and pray with all these other representatives of other faiths. And there's pressure. You know, I'm a part of the police chaplaincy, and there has been pressure in that. You know, maybe don't pray in the name of Jesus. You know, pray, close out a different way. You know, close out like in his name. If you close out in his name, then it's not so offensive, because after all, you got Muslims on the platform and you've got Buddhists on the platform, and you got, and let me tell you what, they're praying in the name of Allah. You know, so I pray in the name of Jesus, because Allah, he ain't real. But Jesus is real. And Jesus, when I pray in the name of Jesus, that's been made possible through a death and a resurrection. So why would I not pray in the name of Jesus? It's the one thing that makes it exclusive of all other religions, because of the name of Jesus. Stop and consider that. Don't be ashamed or afraid to pray in the name of Jesus, because you're declaring faith before men. It's your son, and I believe he's your son, and I believe you sent him, and I love him. And he's going to smile. And then you're also connecting with his authority, because he's the King of Kings and he's the Lord of Lords. It's the name that Father God is moved by. It's the only phrase given to pray by. Amen? Amen. Let's see, I got any other notes here? I do, a little on the back. Philippians 2, 10. Now I'm saving it for the end so we can understand what's behind in the name of Jesus. So that the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. Of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and the glory of God the Father. Everyone will bow and pray and confess that name. Everyone will bow and confess and pray that name. Everybody on that platform when I go in May, at some point their eternal life is going to bow and say the name of Jesus. Every one of them. Either now or later. And that won't be sweet like candy. I'm sorry. Couldn't pass it up. Remember now laters? Yeah, sorry. I used to love those. It's a good thing to tear your teeth up and make fillings come out, but they're good. But it won't be sweet in that instance. So why not now? Don't allow the name of Jesus to be despised by the thoughts and conduct of other men who are also made in the image of God. I'm so stirred by that. We used that text a couple of weeks ago where Paul comes in there to that city and they're worshiping this image of some unknown God, right? And he jumps in. He's so, I look at it, you know, it's, today we'd say, oh, he's judging them, or he's been, your brother, you gotta do this in love. No, he's passionate in love to tell them. He says, men, why are you doing this thing? You're created in the image of God. When you look at that video and you see those people, you'd say, hey, do you not realize you're created in the image of God? Don't do this vain thing. Don't do it. And in this, I believe we should be encouraged to not allow people to despise the thoughts to not allow the name of Jesus to be despised by the thoughts and the conduct of other men. We shouldn't allow it. For Paul, that incident didn't work out too good for him. They stoned him and left him for dead. You might get stoned and left for dead. You know, some of the things that we're doing and we might get called to do in the future might wind up putting protesters all out. You might have to come to church and drive through protesters and they're going to be calling you a bigot, fascist, racist. You know, you never know. Hello? Deplorable. Whatever. No, can't run them over. What we'll do is go buy them water and pray for them and maybe move our PA out on the driveway and let them hear our worship and preach Jesus to them, you know, whatever. But that day's ahead of you. You're living in a crazy world. You know, you go to look at Revelations and look at some of the prophecies and how, you know, it says even children turning against their own parents, family turning against family. And people are going to do some crazy things when all of a sudden you can't get employed and you can't buy groceries. Forget the mark of the beast. Just look at what businesses are doing right now. The mark of the beast might not have anything to do with how we thought traditionally gets stamped. It might be just the fact that you're going against the system. And just because you're going against the system, you're not going to be able to go buy your groceries. You're not going to be able, we're not going to let you in. We're not going to do, you're seeing it already. And so, you know, you're still going to come to church. I hope you do. I think you will. I'll be here. Amen. I'll be here. And if I don't see you, I'll be calling you up and find out why you're not here. I will. Yeah, there's a few people, when I don't see them after a while, I'll call them up. There's one young man, I called him up. I said, because I'd already called him like 2 weeks ago and he hadn't showed up. So I called him again. I said, dude, where are you going to church? You know, come on, because it's obviously not here. Oh, man, just like I threw him under the bus. But I only do that because I love him, right? You know, and anyhow, I'm wondering now. Pray in the name of Jesus. It's the only name that moves heaven to earth. Amen. It's the only name that moves heavens to earth. So anyhow, there you go. Get fired up and pray in the name of Jesus. And don't be ashamed of the name of Jesus. It is preparing us.
This is preparing us. We're being filled with courage now.
Yep.
So that when the day comes that we won't faint.
Yeah. Yeah. It is a little unnerving. You know, we drove up to that meeting on that Thursday and yep. I'd just gotten up. I hadn't really woke up. I had a couple cups of coffee, but it was not on my mind that I was fixing to have to walk through protesters to go to that meeting. I wasn't thinking about that. You know, and then at first I kind of had a little nervousness about it, and then my amusing side kicks in, and I'm like, come on, Linda, this is fun. And turned my camera on and just recorded them as I walked in, and God bless you, have a great day. And, you know, it was just nice to them, and that's what you do. You know, think of Robert Jeffries Church, First Baptist Dallas. They got people picking it out in their church all the time. Calling them a bigot and everything else. And, you know, they do. They buy them water. They go out there and try to feed them, buy them pizza, you know. Just keep loving them. And but yet stand for the truth and don't back down on what's true. Because what else? Do you stand there and watch them go to hell? Do we sit there silently and just watch them go to hell? Rather than speaking the truth to them and loving them and doing our part. Paul certainly did it, amen? He certainly did it. The 10 disciples that died martyrs certainly did it. I think it's historically what the church tells us we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to serve the Lord in his kingdom. Amen. Because guess what? You live forever. Amen. You live forever. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. Yeah. 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 Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, they are. Amen. Amen. That's good. Yes, sir. Amen. Yep. 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 Yeah, because, you know, by a lot of, I was just having this conversation with my son the other night. By the grace of God, go I, you know. And, if it hadn't been for an encounter with the Lord Jesus and Him changing my life, you know, I'd be no different. And but thank God there were some people praying for me and some people speaking the truth to me. And that's what we have to do. Amen. We got about 10 minutes, so let's close out praying together and be praying for our leaders and be praying particularly for the state of Texas and what's going on in the Capitol with this SB6 and that they'll be courageous and stand their ground and that the church will rise up. And I'm just going to start spreading the word to other pastors I know, just emailing it to everybody and just trying to get people riled up and active and vocal and making a stand. And so, amen. There you go. Let's pray.